हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू एडवांस नॉलेज सिस्टम्स एंड वार्म वेलकम टू AKS IAS एकेडमी एंड इट ऑफर्स एग्जामिनेशन कोचिंग फॉर UPSC CSE स्टेट पब्लिक सर्विस कमीशन SSC कंबाइंड ग्रेजुएट लेवल एंड CLAT examinations. एंड अबाउट मी आई एम संदीप भूषण तुम्मला एंड आई टेक अप द एनालिसिस ऑफ द हिंदू न्यूज़पेपर दैट इज द DNA of today's, that is 15th of April 2021. And throughout my session, I would be emphasizing on the keywords and the key phrases from the Hindu newspaper, wherein we will try to identify the factual, analytical and conceptual questions, which will be critical for UPSC prelims examination. And also while you imbibe the keywords and the key phrases in your answer writing for the mains examination, your answers would be precise and concise, and thereby you would score higher marks in the mains examination. So this session at AKS IAS Academy Daily News Analysis will certainly help you to clear both prelims and mains of the year 2021. And before we get into the DNA of the newspaper, we would be focusing at the quote of the day. And the quote of the day says that great things never come from comfort zones. So definitely, if you wanted to achieve great, then you need to move out of the comfort zone and then start doing the things which are not usual. Then definitely great things you can achieve. And now we'll get into the DNA of the newspaper. And here it is in regards to the access to the education. So definitely the access to education is a fundamental right. And this is what is being pronounced by the Supreme Court. A bench of justices D.Y. Chandrachud and M.R. Shah have put forth their pronouncement of the verdict in favor of two students from Ladakh, wherein they have moved to the Supreme Court when their fundamental rights to education were at the whims and fancies of the government authorities in Ladakh. And thereby, when they have approached the Supreme Court has given the verdict in favor of the two students that these two students were nominated by the Union Territory Administration for MBBS studies. While they were nominated and they were also allocated to the prestigious medical colleges such as Lady Harding and Maulana Azad medical colleges, but they were not admitted. So as they were not admitted, even though they were nominated and allotted seats in the medical colleges by the Union Territory Administration of Ladakh for the MBBS students, so then the students have moved to the Supreme Court saying that the fundamental rights to education were at the whims and fancies of the government authorities, especially in Ladakh. And in turn, when the students have moved to the Supreme Court, the court has said that the state has the affirmative obligation to facilitate access to education at all levels. Please do understand, at all levels. This is the key understanding of the verdict which has been pronounced by the Supreme Court in regards to the education to all levels. That is, the state has the affirmative obligation to facilitate access to education at all levels. And this obligation assumes that state has a greater importance for students whose background is imposing formidable obstacle. That means their background from where the students have come from, whether their background, if it is a kind of obstacle to the path to access quality education, then it is the obligation of the state that they provide the access. That is, they should facilitate access to education at all levels. This is a key word. Facilitate access is the key word which this court has said to the states. It is the affirmative obligation to facilitate access. And this could be that background wherein the students whose background is imposing a formidable obstacle can be the caste, class, gender, religion, disability, or even the geographical region, which could pose a formidable obstacle for the students on their path to accessing quality education, then it is the responsibility of the state or the affirmative obligation of the state to facilitate access to education at all levels. And the court also has said that even though the right to pursue higher or professional education has not been spelled out in the fundamental rights in part 3 of the constitution, but still it bears, that is the state bears emphasis, or the court is facing, or it is emphasizing that the state has to provide an access to the professional education. And this providing the access to the professional education by the state is not a governmental largesse. Largesse in the sense that providing professional education is not a money or gifts given by generously. That means it is the duty or affirmative obligation of the state to facilitate access to education at all levels. So this is the pronouncement or the verdict of the Supreme Court in regards to the access to education, which the students have moved to the top court for justice, saying that it is a fundamental right to education, wherein the Union Territory Administration of Ladakh has not allocated or admitted the students for the MBBS studies. And the court also has spoken about a vision. So we will look at what vision the Supreme Court has taken into consideration, or it has referred to the vision. So the Supreme Court has referred to the vision, which is envisaged by a committee called on economic, social and cultural rights. So definitely there is a vision by the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and this vision has been referred by the Supreme Court in making sure that it is the state's affirmative obligation to facilitate access to education at all levels. And it said that as an empowerment right, education is the primary vehicle by which a person or an individual or a citizen who is economically and socially marginalized, or these adults and the children's, they can make sure that these economically and socially marginalized adults and children's can lift themselves out of poverty. And not only just lifting themselves out of poverty, but they can also obtain the means to participate fully in their communities. And what is that called as? That is the empowerment right. Please do understand the keyword, that is empowerment right. As an empowerment right, education is the primary vehicle by which economically and socially marginalized people can lift themselves out of poverty and obtain means to participate fully in their communities. And it also said that it is the government policy which has been taken up by the government, that is Ladakh Union Territory Administration, last November 2020 to allot one seat each to Lady Harding and Maulana Azad Medical Colleges from the central pool. So you have the central pool. So the government or the Ladakh Union Territory has taken into consideration that from the central pool, they will allocate one seat at, that is for the MBBS students at Lady Harding Medical College, and the other one is the Maulana Azad Medical Colleges. And in turn, the court has noted that India was a signatory to the United Nations International Covenant on Economic and Social Cultural Rights. Please do understand here the court, how it is definitely making sure that the verdict given or the pronouncement of the verdict by the Supreme Court, that the state has an obligation and it has to create, or it has to create and facilitate the kind of opportunity for education at all levels, is being referred by the vision of Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights in India. And it is also noting that India is a signatory to the United Nations International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. So these are the two points or the keywords which have been referred by the Supreme Court. And then the court has ordered that the students be admitted within a week in the MBBS colleges, that is Lady Harding and Maulana Azad Medical Colleges, which it is been alerted from the central pool. So this is part of the polity, and then focusing in regards to the access to education. And the court has said that, that is the Supreme Court has said that it is the state's affirmative obligation to facilitate access to education at all levels, as it is a fundamental right. And now another news which talks about the pacts. So we will be focusing on the pacts especially in regards to the regional trade pacts. And the Singapore Foreign Minister Vivian Balakrishnan, while he was at the Raisina Dialogue, which was held virtually, and Raisina Dialogue is hosted by Observer Research Foundation and in partnership with India's Ministry of External Affairs. So this is the conceptual understanding application part, which you need to also understand that the Raisini Dialogue, because there could be a possibility in the prelims that which among the following statements are incorrect. So Raisini Dialogue is hosted by the Observer Research Foundation in partnership with India's Ministry of External Affairs. So the ministry which is partnering in hosting the Raisini Dialogue with the Observer Research Foundation is Ministry of External Affairs. And the Singapore Foreign Minister Balakrishnan has hoped that India would reassess its stand on regional trading agreements. So regional trading agreements have taken the center stage at the Raisini Dialogue, and Singapore Foreign Minister has raised, or he has hoped that India would reassess its stand, India's stand on the regional trading agreements such as RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, which India has withdrew from the RCEP in the year 2019. So it is, Singapore is making it very clear that how important India's point, or India being part of the RCEP, which is a regional trading agreement, and which India has withdrew from 2019, and now Singapore Foreign Minister would wish, or he is hoping, that India would reassess its withdrawal in the year 2019 from the RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And he also says that India had a crucial role in helping the region build the inclusive architecture. So here the keyword is inclusive architecture. So how India is, or India has played a crucial role in helping the region build an inclusive architecture that was open and inclusive at a time. And this is at a time when increasing global instability is occurring across the world because of the COVID-19 pandemic situation, and also else before, how India has played a crucial role in helping the region, that is in regards to the ASEAN region or Southeast Asian countries, that India would play an important role or a crucial role in building an inclusive architecture during the global instability. And Singapore Foreign Minister has also hoped that India will reassess the regional trade pacts such as we discussed RCEP, except that it will also look into being part of the comprehensive and progressive agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. So these are the two regional trade pacts which the Singapore Foreign Minister is hoping that India would reassess, the RCEP and CPTPP. So earlier CPTPP was called as Trans-Pacific Partnership, but now it is now framed as Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership, because when US has withdrawn from TPP, then the name of the TPP has been framed as Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. And the RCEP has come into force in the year 2020, but it has come into force after India has withdrew in the year 2019. It has come into force in the year 2020, but without India. And RCEP is the world's largest trading agreement. This is a key phrase. RCEP, it is the world's largest trading agreement, and this RCEP, it covers 10 ASEAN nations along with China, Japan, South Korea, Australia and New Zealand. That means RCEP has 15 countries in total, along with 10 ASEAN countries with China, Japan, South Korea, Australia and New Zealand. And the another regional trading pact is CPTPP. As I said earlier, it was Trans-Pacific Partnership, but after US has withdrew from TPP, then it has been named, and it is the successor. CPTPP is a successor of TPP, that is Trans-Pacific Partnership. And this CPTPP includes Singapore, Brunei, Malaysia, and Vietnam from ASEAN countries. And apart from ASEAN countries, the Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership includes the countries such as, along with the ASEAN, it includes Australia, New Zealand, Japan, Canada, Mexico, Chile, and Peru. So these are the two regional pacts which we need to focus from economy perspective, and that is especially in regards to the trade perspective. And definitely we need to have the better understanding about the RCEP and the CPTPP, and this is based on the economy, that is in regards to the trade pacts. That too, when we are focusing on the trade, it is the regional trade pacts which India had a crucial role in playing, making sure that it helps the region build an inclusive architecture. And apart from that, there is a keyword which has been brought in during this Raisini dialogue, and the Singapore Foreign Minister has spoken about the ASEAN centrality. So ASEAN centrality is been mentioned by the Singapore Foreign Minister Balakrishnan, because at the midst of the US-China tension, that is the rising US-China tension, which is deeply worrying the entire region, that is ASEAN. Now, it is not only in regards to the US-China tension, but it is also because of the pandemic situation, which is a heightened tension, also is creating, or it is deeply worrying the ASEAN countries. And now there are various contests in the ASEAN region itself, that is in regards to the emerging technologies, divergence on human rights, and also tensions related to defense and cyber security. So we would be focusing on what are the contests, especially because of the US-China tensions and the pandemic in the ASEAN, which is deeply worrying, is because of the technology, human rights, defense, technology, human rights, defense and cybersecurity issues. So these are the one which has been focused in the Raisini dialogue by the Singapore Foreign Minister Balakrishnan, that ASEAN centrality is the one which has to be focused. And not only ASEAN, but along with the ASEAN, Southeast Asia. He says that Southeast Asia is more crucial to maintain ASEAN centrality. So if you wanted to maintain ASEAN centrality and unity, what is very important is focusing on the Southeast Asia is more crucial to maintain ASEAN centrality and unity. And this is that the focus should be on the Southeast Asia amidst the geopolitical competition, which is growing and which is definitely a deeply worrying for the region of the ASEAN centrality and the unity. And he has also focused not only the rising US-China tension, pandemic, and the importance or the way the crucial focus has to be made on Southeast Asia to maintain ASEAN centrality and unity, but he has also focused on Myanmar, which there is a coup. The military has taken over the country, and it says that ASEAN wanted to stop the violence, and he wanted that there should be a dialogue between, direct dialogue between the military leadership and the National League for Democracy, so that there would be democracy which would be restored back in Myanmar. So his focus is in regards to the Southeast Asia and also in regards to the ASEAN centrality. And for the maintaining of ASEAN centrality and unity, he has focused on the Southeast Asia. And in further, when we are focusing on the Southeast Asia, what is very important is the utmost, the prime importance is that the need of the hour is that the kind of scenario which is going on in Myanmar, that the violence should be stopped, and that could happen only through the direct dialogue between the military leadership and the National League for Democracy. So these are the keywords which you need to focus. That is, ASEAN centrality is the keyword which you need to focus, and then regional trade pacts in regards to the RCEP, again Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, and then Comprehensive and Progressive Agreement for Trans-Pacific Partnership. And these are the one which you need to focus along with the Raisini dialogue. So these are very important or crucial for the UPSC prelims as well as mains perspective, that how India would play, or India had a role, crucial role in helping build the region, that is ASEAN centrality. And there is another news which talks about PAK to ban radical Islamist party. So the Pakistan has now, or the Pakistan government has decided to ban an Islamist party that is called as Radical Islamist Party, and it has decided to ban under the Terrorism Act. So there is an act in Pakistan, and under the Terrorism Act, that is of 1997, Pakistan has decided to ban a radical Islamist party because its supporters have clashed with the law enforcement agencies for 3 consecutive days, and 7 persons were dead in the clashes between the law enforcement agency and the supporters of the radical Islamist party, and 300 policemen were injured. And because of this, the result of this, that is 7 persons being dead and 300 persons, policemen injured, the Pakistani government had decided to ban the Radical Islamist Party under the rule 11B of Anti-Terrorism Act of 1997. And the Radical Islamist Party, which is being decided by the Pakistan government to be banned, is called as Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan, TLP, which is a political party. But because its supporters have clashed with the law enforcement agencies for 3 consecutive days, and it has led to 7 persons dead and 300 policemen injured, the Interior Minister Sheikh Rashid Ahmed has decided and also told to the media that they have banned the Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan under Rule 11B of Anti-Terrorism Act of 1997. And this TLP has launched a countrywide protest on April 12th because on April 12th, there was an arrest of the TLP chief, that is Saad Hussain Rizvi. Because this Saad Hussain Rizvi was arrested by the Pakistan government because the TLP had given a deadline, that is April 20, to the Imran Khan government, that they were demanding the expulsion of the French ambassador because the French government has supported for Charlie Hebdo magazine. Please do understand here, this is a conceptual understanding why the Pakistan has taken a decision, or Pakistan government has taken a decision to ban the TLP, which is a political party, because the TLP has launched a countrywide protest. And in the midst of the protest, the government has arrested the chief of TLP, that is Saad Hussain Rizvi, because the TLP has given a deadline to the Imran Khan government of the deadline, that is of April 20, that they wanted the expulsion of the French ambassador because the French government has supported for Charlie Hebdo magazine, wherein the Charlie Hebdo magazine has republished the cartoons of the Prophet Muhammad. And this is the reason, because you need to understand the conceptual, the reason why the Pakistan government has taken a decision to ban the TLP under the Anti-Terrorist Act of 1997, because of this reason. And the TLP has also contested in the 2018 general elections, which were held in Pakistan, and they have bagged the 2.5 million votes. But still, they have gone against the decision of the Imran Khan government, and they have gone ahead with a kind of deadline to the government that they expel the French ambassador. And the another news is in regards to the public debt level. And India's public debt level is highest among the emerging economies in the world. And this has been taken up, or it is by the report of Moody's Investor Service, which says that public debt level is highest in the emerging economies, and the debt affordability is the weakest among the emerging economies. So these are the two keywords which you need to focus for the economy perspective of prelims, that is public debt level and debt affordability. So as per Moody's Investment Services, public debt level of India is among the highest in emerging economies, and the debt affordability is among the weakest. And if you look at the public debt level, it is highest because India is going ahead with a program called as quantitative easing program. This is another keyword which you need to focus, that the RBI is taking up, or the RBI is aiming to stabilize the domestic bond market. RBI has taken an aim to stabilize the domestic bond market, and it has come up with a program under the title called as quantitative easing programs are largely positive but risk vary across economies. So the program taken up by the RBI is quantitative easing program, but definitely it also says that there are risk, and the risk varies from various countries, that is emerging economies. But if you look at among the 11 emerging economies or the markets, India has the weak government effectiveness, and it suggests that political risks are involved while they are executing the fiscal reforms and or in regards to the consolidation of plans. And the one among the 11 emerging economies which is an exception in regards to the public debt is Chile. And in regards to the debt affordability, there is a widely varying aspect of debt affordability with Ghana and India, and that is why it is now debt affordability is the weakest, and it is rated as Baa3 negative. And this is again another keyword which is crucial for the prelims perspective, which could be which among these following statements are incorrect in regards to the debt affordability. And the debt affordability between Ghana and India is rated at Baa3 negative. And across the 11 emerging markets, the public debt which is very weakest, or the public debt which is very high and the debt affordability which is weakest, are the countries such as India, South Africa and Ghana. Please do understand, India, South Africa and Ghana have the highest public debt and weakest debt affordability. So we have focused on two keywords here. What is that? That is in regards to the public debt and the debt affordability. So what is very important for you as a civil servant aspirant is that you need to focus at the keywords of public debt and debt affordability, because there could be a possibility of UPSC framing the question based on the two keywords, public debt and debt affordability. Because among the 11 emerging economies in the world, India has the highest public debt and the weakest debt affordability. So it is important, and now we will focus at what is public debt and what is debt affordability. So when we look at what is debt affordability, so these are very crucial for prelims perspective and also better conceptual understanding in regards to the economy or economic terms. That is, a public affordability should be a forward looking. When we say that the study of public or debt affordability should be forward looking, it should be with the current and anticipated obligations. That is, the study should be focusing the current and anticipated obligations, and it should be analyzed against the expected resources. What are the expected resources which are available to repay the outstanding debt? Please do understand here. So the entire concept is to repay the outstanding debt. And while we are in the process of repaying the outstanding debt, the debt affordability is a forward-looking, which would be focusing on the current and the anticipated obligations, which will clearly analyze against the expected resources, so that this forward-looking against the expected resources to repay the outstanding debt is called as debt affordability. Please do understand here, it is the repaying of outstanding debt. But while repaying the outstanding debt, it is a study which we need to focus at the current and the anticipated obligations against the expected resources. So it is the current and the anticipated obligations against or versus the expected resources. Current and anticipated obligations versus expected resources. And these are why this is a steady to repay the outstanding debt. That is called a debt affordability. And this debt affordability also states to manage. It would manage the budget and the borrowings, which would anticipate and prepare for the changes in revenue. So that this debt affordability would anticipate for the changes in revenue. So we have looked at what is debt affordability. Now we will focus at what is public debt. Public debt is nothing but it is a total amount which includes liabilities borrowed by the government so that it meets the developmental budget. So for the all the developmental activities, the budget which is required is including the liabilities and the borrowed by the government is called as the public debt, and it is paid from the consolidated fund of India. Please do understand, it is paid from the public debt is paid from the consolidated fund of India, and this could also be a perspective for prelims UPSC. And the source of public debt, what are the, now we'll look at what are the sources. So the sources for public debt are the government securities, treasury bills, external assistance and short-term borrowings. So how does the government tries to make sure that it meets the developmental budget is by the dated government securities, treasury bills, external assistance and short-term borrowings. And it has to be paid from the consolidated fund of India. And public debt is a total amount including the liabilities borrowed by the government so that it meets the developmental budget. So we have focused on what the Moody's Investment Services has said about India's public debt level and debt affordability. So we have focused exclusively from prelims perspective and also understanding the conceptual, which could be useful for the mains point of view. And now I would say a very big thank you, because I feel this was informative, knowledgeable and also very critical for mains and prelims perspective. And I would say good luck, and then do maintain consistency, stick to your schedule and take care of your physical and mental health. And do not forget to like the video, share the video and subscribe the AKS IAS Academy English Medium YouTube channel, and also have access to the website and Telegram link of AKS IAS Academy. And see you again tomorrow with the daily news analysis at AKS IAS Academy. Till then, thank you, goodbye and then take care.